Good morning. So far we have been handling data input and output using our keyboard as an input medium and the monitor as an output medium. And we type in ASCII characters, they go in through C in, and C out produces an output ASCII character stream which comes out on the monitor. But if you want data to be stored persistently, you cannot store it in memory variables inside, because the moment computer program executes completely, at the end there are no memory contents left. So you would like your data to be preserved for later use, and for that you use external files. These are typically stored on external storage devices. In the introductory video, I had told you about the three types of disk devices. One is the conventional magnetic disk, which typically comes now in a terabyte capacity or 2 terabyte capacity. Then you have what we call solid state disks, which are like memory on the disk or ROM disks. And you also have optical disks, which are CDs and DVDs. Capacities differ, the speeds differ, but essentially data remains persistent. You can store it, forget it, anytime later, tomorrow, 1 month later, 1 year later, you can actually read data from those devices. How is that data organized on those devices? It is organized in files. Now, files are not handled directly by C++ programs or programs written in any language. Files are always handled by the operating system which runs the computer. Operating system has a component called file manager or file system which handles these. As a result, each file is given a name and a path, which is a location of the file on the disk. It has a size, and each file has access permissions associated with that. For example, if I create a file, I can set permissions so that nobody else will be able to read it, or all others can read it, but nobody can modify it, and so on. All files which are written on disk are modifiable. They can be extended. The operating system manages the allocation of space on the disk appropriately and handles them. Now, a C++ program can define and use files, but internally, a C++ program uses what is known as file pointers. And the name of the file pointer becomes the file name within a program. Of course, such a pointer name cannot be used unless you associate that internal pointer file name with a physical file external. Such an association can be done through functions which are available in C++. The normal input output that we do, we presume that C in directly gets input from keyboard and C out directly produces output on monitor, but that is not strictly true. All input output inside a computer happens through the notion of a file. So the operating system actually automatically makes available to you two files. One is called std in for standard input, and the other is called std out for standard output. Whenever you start a program execution, these two files are created by operating system and are opened and are made available to you. Also, by default, std in is connected to the keyboard and std out is associated to the monitor. So this happens automatically. That is why whenever you say C in > something, the operating system reads the stream of ASCII bytes from your keyboard and then hand over that particular line or record or whatever to your program. It is possible to reconnect the std in and std out to some other files, not necessarily keyboard and monitor. This is called redirection. If you execute a program from the terminal, so either on Ubuntu, you go to a terminal, you go to the directory in which code blocks has compiled that program, and you execute that program, then it is possible to give a command like this: myprog, which is a compiled version, <infile.txt> <outfile.txt>. This less than symbol stands for input redirection. That means std in, instead of being connected to keyboard, will now get connected to a file on the disk called infile.txt. Naturally, this file should exist in the same directory in which your program is. If it exists somewhere else, you will have to specify the complete path name of that file. In exactly the same fashion, you can do an output redirection, and the output can be redirected to a file which is stored on the disk. So you don't see any output then on the terminal, because all output will go to that file. But the advantage is that file is persistent. You can read it later any number of times. And if you run the same program 3 times, you can actually create the output and redirect it to three different files. So you can actually have the outputs of all the executions independently and persistently available to you. Redirection can be only for input or for output, not necessarily for both. There is actually a third standard file which is also opened by the operating system for each C++ program that executes. It is called STDERR or standard error file. The operating system uses this file to write all error messages, and you can actually write to STDERR. Let us also discuss two functions which are used to analyze text input in a formatted fashion and to create formatted output. These functions are the traditional functions from C programming language which continue to exist in C++. The C programming language did not have any input-output instructions. It did not have operators like C in or C out. Consequently, everybody used only these functions. Let's understand what these functions are. The printf function converts values as per a specified format string and produces it on stdout. So for example, if I say printf followed by this funny looking string, comma, roll, comma, batch. Assume that roll is an integer value 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and batch is another integer value 1, 1, 2. Then this printf will actually produce an output line containing values of roll and batch, and the first string that is written here is called the format specifier string. So this has various format specifiers. Each format specifier is identified by a percent symbol. So percent 5D actually means convert the internal value into a 5 ASCII character space. Percent 3D means convert the corresponding integer value in 3 character space. Of course, if the value is larger than that, you will have funny results, but that is your choice. If you don't put any 5 or 3, for example, the conversion will take as many positions as are required. More importantly, this formatting string, apart from contain format specifiers, and there must be one format specifier for each variable or expression that you write later. In addition, you can write any characters in that string, and those characters will appear verbatim on the output. For example, you will notice that there is a blank here. This blank will appear as is. There is a new line character here. This will appear as is on the output. So consequently, this will produce an output 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1 blank, 112 / If you had put 4 blanks here, you would have got 4 blanks. If you had put a tab character here, you would have got tab character. If you had written abracadabra, the abracadabra would have come. So you would have got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, abracadabra, 1, 1. Whatever you write, whatever characters you write, they will come verbatim. So please note, the format string consists of two components. One, the format specifiers, which must be as many as there are variables, and there should be corresponding format specifiers there. And two, any number of other characters which are reproduced verbatim as they are ending. This is for printing out. For input, the operation is similar but works slightly different. For example, if I have m and n as integer, x and y as float, and a character string 40, and I want to read these values from an input line. Ordinarily, you would have said C in greater greater M greater greater N greater greater X greater greater Y greater greater name, and you would have given the values. But in a scanf kind of function call, you would put a format string and then write and M and N and X and Y. Why? Because scanf is supposed to collect value and bring it into the variables that you have defined. So variable values must change, and therefore you must pass them by reference. That is why the pointers are to be passed, add them and. Note that name does not have an explicit and before it. Why? Because the name is the name of an array, and the array name itself is a pointer to the 0th element. So implicitly it's a pointer. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 values that are expected, and you will notice the format string contains 5 specifiers. %d, %d, %f, %f, %s. %d is integer, %d is integer, %f is floating point, %s is characters. %c would be a single character, %s is a string. Notice that there is one blank in between each of these. Now the blank in a format specifier for scanf is interpreted differently. One blank stands for any number of blanks or white spaces. So white space includes tab character, for example. Consequently, if you type a line which has 5 blanks between two values, they are all equivalently represented by a single blank. So one blank means any number of white places. Consequently, if I type this line, 25 blank 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 minus 78 blank blank 0.00763 blank this, or I type this line as blank 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 25 blank 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 minus 78 blank blank 7.63 e minus 3 is a valid representation, just as I would have written it inside a program, can actually give an input value. Scanf will interpret these values correctly and will assign exactly the same values to all the variables. Please note that the character string that I input cannot contain a blank. If it contains a blank, scanf, like cin, terminates consideration of those bytes, any function. So blank is actually a separator anyway, at the end. If you do not want a blank to affect reading of values, for example, if my input data line is this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, fan belt, 150.50. This is a typical sample of a subset of what we call an inventory record. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 may be an item identifier. Fan belt may be an item code, which is a character string. And 150.50 may be the value in rupees that is paid on an average for one fan belt. Why am I not giving space in between? Actually, when I type, I can give a space. But please notice that such inventory records for lakhs of items will be actually persistently stored in a file. And when you store in a file, you don't want to waste storage space there. There is no great advantage of putting a blank in between different values, because a human being is not going to read those. Computer is going to read them. So you would like to preserve space, and you might want to have a record on the desk which looks like this. Unfortunately, cin cannot read this as three different values. It will read it as if a continuous string, not meaning anything other than a character string. However, if you use scanf and give %6d, %7s and %f, and these are the reference variable and a item code and x. Notice that item code is a char string, so this itself stands for a pointer. This will correctly read the values. So this will, for example, interpret the first 5-6 characters as the value for A, immediately the next 7 characters as value for item code, and immediately subsequent characters till you find a space as value for X, because you have said %f. If you had given a specific number of characters for width of F, then that would have read exactly those many. Now this is a facility which scanf provides. I would advise you to read, as was stated in the lectures, that you should read C++ tutorials online, which exhaustively define scanf and printf format specifiers. I think Abhiram Narade's book also gives enough details for that. There are variations of these scanf and printf functions which are very useful. For example, instead of interpreting data which is typed on input, or instead of creating an output line on a monitor, because what is being read in is a string of characters, what is being put out is a string of characters, I could actually read an entire line in some string variable, or compose a string variable, string array internally, and then output that entire characters. So it is possible to apply scanf and printf on strings which are internal. That is done by sprintf and scanf. They work exactly like scanf and printf, except that for sprintf, the destination is not a terminal or std out, but the destination is a string s, which is a character array variable that you have identified. Similarly, for scanf, the source is not keyboard, but the source is the string s. So somehow you have read an entire input line in some character string, then you can apply scanf to interpret values if they are different values, right? Exactly the same functions can be applied to lines in a text file. So instead of in an internal string, if suppose such a string exists in a text file, we shall see how text files are organized. But you can imagine, I mean, the program that you type, for example, is stored in a text file. So text file is nothing but a series of lines. So if you want to write a line on an output file, or if you want to read a line from an input file, then instead of using scanf, which will insist on working on stdin, you can write fscanf, which means do the same thing as scanf, but read the line from fpin, which is a file pointer. Remember, I mentioned that you will have a file pointer. Of course, a file pointer will have to be appropriately associated with an external file. We shall see that shortly. Similarly, output a formatted line to a text file, you say fprintf. These are the variations of printf and scanf, which are extremely useful whenever you are dealing with text data or converting text data into internal variables and vice versa. Just to take this further, there is an example of how the text data gets created in an external file to begin with. You can type the text data in laboriously, but when you are talking about thousands or millions of lines, such data usually comes from some other application. There are specialized data entry programs, for example, which will capture information, let's say, about a new account that has been opened in a bank. A typical bank in India had 2 crore, 4 crore accounts. On any one day, there may be 20,000 accounts that are opened across the country. The people fill up the form, but the data entry for that is done at a back office somewhere, the common place. Now, they can't afford to write a C++ program which will read every line. What if there are mistakes? There is an elaborate process of entering the data in a file, then somebody verifies that data, and then only that entire file is processed by the banking system to create the account. In exactly the similar way, a spreadsheet can be used to create text files. You are familiar with spreadsheets, whether it is Microsoft or OpenOffice or any other spreadsheet. You will generally have, for example, this is an example of a spreadsheet which has, for each row, contains data about one student. It has roll number, it has name, it has a lab batch, for example, 112, 111, etc., and it has marks in some quiz. So these are the elements. Of course, I can have more columns, but these are the typical columns in one sample spreadsheet. Now, these spreadsheets are stored in special internal formats by the programs which work on them. So whether it is any utility, as I said, Microsoft, OpenOffice, or any number of other spreadsheets you use, they store data in their peculiar format. However, all of them are capable of saving the data in an ordinary text format, which is called comma separated values format, or CSV format. If you store any spreadsheet, you can try it out, enter some rows and save it as .csv file. Then the file that you will get will be actually a text file which will look like this. 10101, comma, Anil Shah, comma, 112, comma, 12.5. 10106, comma, Avinash Atsway, comma, 112, comma, 14, etc. Now, this is more, or this is similar to the kind of data that you handle, except that it has commas. Comma separated value is what ordinarily you will save. You can actually give any separator while saving the file, but this is the most common form. Why I am showing this is, we will be discussing a program written to read such lines. Okay. Please note that these lines cannot be easily read through CIN, because this comma is a nutty character. We do not know how to handle it in CIN. We also do not know how to handle it in scanf, although you can figure that out. But let us say, for the illustration purposes of using external files, we shall be treating this data file as a text file which is to be used as input. And we want to create an output file, for example, which is also a text file, but it does not have comma, it instead has blank spaces. Because once we have blank separated values, then we know exactly how to handle it by fscanf or whatever. So a program to process data from a CSV file is essentially to read one line from the input file as a single string, say line string. So the first line is 10101, Anil Shah, etc., etc. This entire line is read in line string. Now, the logic that I have decided to use here is, this string itself consists of 4 strings. The first string is roll number, second string is name, third string is batch, and fourth string is marks. All text string. So let's say arbitrarily I decide that I will separate out the 4 parts in 4 different strings. Then I have now 4 different strings. I will interpret each string and convert that value into an appropriate internal format. For example, I can define int sr, char sn30, int sb, float sf. What are these? This is the roll number, this is the name, this is the student's batch, and this is the student's mark. So these are internal variables. Observe that this is exactly to using a cin or scanner. But I'm just illustrating the process. So my process is, I associate my internal file pointer with an external input file. Then I will read one line from that input file, do all of this, convert this. Now I want to create an output line. I will create an output line by separated by blank spaces together in a string, which is called outstring. So I'm internally constructing an outstring and then write this string to the output file. So I have an input file, I have an output file. I am not doing any redirection, but I am actually associating that input file with a file pointer, output file with a file pointer, reading a string from input file, doing all this processing, creating an output string, and writing output string to the output file. This is exactly how text files are ordinarily processed. Of course, I'll repeat this procedure to process all lines from the input file. So let's quickly recap the program. This is the program logic. Read one line of input file. While the file continues to contain more records, do all of this. Please note that any while or do while requires a condition. Observe what you do when you use cin to read data for n students. What is the typical way? There are two ways that you will use. Either you will count how many students are there, say 575 in CS10. So you will first read n, 575, and then read n lines. But suppose two students are missing a quiz, then that data is not there. Then there is an artificial method that you can follow, namely that you say keep reading the data till you get a roll number which is minus one, for example. Now you will, the moment you input minus one, C++ can test it and say, oh, the input has ended. But both the methods are artificial. In case of files, the operating system actually is capable of telling you whenever you issue a read command to the operating system to read a record from that file, read a line from that file, the operating system will either give you a line or will give you a signal, sorry, there is no line, file has ended. The end of file is indicated by setting a flag called FOEF. We shall see that later. So when that flag comes, you know that there is no more record. That is why the while loop is not end of file for the input. While not end of file for the input file, you keep doing. Of course, as usual, you read the first line before entering the while, process that line. So processing means separate parts in four strings, convert each part in internal variables, then recreate an output text string with these four values, write this output string to output file, and read next input line inline string and go back. Please note that when you read the next input line, you will again come to the while condition here. What it means is that next input line, suppose there was no more line, then the operating system will say end of file and you can get out of the while. This is a simple logic. Here is what a sample one line, 10101, A, N, I, L. So Adil Shah, for example. These are the values. Now what I want to do is I want to read this into a string, then separate out this string into four separate strings. S-roll is a string, S-name is a string, S-batch is a string, S-marks is a string. Artificial decision, I mean, I could have processed it in different ways, but this is what this particular program that is there in the lectures does. The program simply defines all these character variables. It also defines internal variables SR, SN, SB, SM, and some other thing. Most important thing for file processing is definition of two file pointers, FP in and FP out. Notice that file is written as capital FI. So it's a data type. File is a data type in C++, which says that whatever I define, like int x means x is an integer, file star something means file point. So I'm defining two file pointer, fp in and fp out. Please note, these are not the names of the files by which operating system knows those files. These are my internal name. And I can associate this pointer to any external file that I wish. Since I want to read an input file called csv_data.txt, this is the name of the external file. This is what operating system knows it. and notice the association. FP in is equal to F open. So F open is the function call. Effectively, association means open a file for processing. So I'm opening an input file. Notice it has two parameters. One is the name of the file. It could be a complete path name if you want to be very clear where the file is. The second parameter is called mode. R means read. Actually, there are two types of files, text files and binary files. If you don't specify the type, by default, it is a text file. R means open it for reading. W means open some file for writing. There are many other things which you can read in the tutorial. So I'm opening this file. Ordinarily, when I open the file, the operating system will associate csv_data.txt with my pointer FPE. But there is a possibility that this association attempt may fail. Under what circumstances this attempt may fail of opening a file? The file may not exist in that directory. Or if the file exists, I as a user may not have the operating system's permission to read data from that file. Any one of those reasons. In that case, how does the operating system indicate to my program that look, such association has not been established? It does so by sending you a null pointer. If the file is properly opened, you will get a proper pointer, otherwise you will get a null pointer which you examine. If fpin equal equal null, well, give gali gali gali, cannot open file, and return minus. Now, please understand that whenever you are handling files, this should be an absolutely standard way. With closed eyes, you should be able to write. Open a file and examine whether the pointer is null. If the pointer is null, get out, otherwise continue. In exactly the same way, you will open an output file. F out. FP out is equal to FP, F open, marks_data.txt is a file that I am creating. W is the mode, which means it is being created as output. So records will be written on. Again, if FP out is null, why output file cannot be created? Input file we can understand, the file may not exist, etc. I am creating an output file, so what could be the problem? Any guess? We should not call it memory. Memory is the term that is used for the internal memory of the computer, but you are very right. It's actually space on the disk. There is no space on the disk. Or in the directory which I am attempting to create a file, I may not have write permission to that directory given by the operating system. Please note that files are managed by operating system. My programs do not control them directly. Okay, so these are some of the things. There is a third possibility. Somebody else might, or I might myself have created a file called marks_data.txt. So a file called by this name already exists inside. What would happen in that case? Yeah. Unfortunately, operating system doesn't care if a file by the same name exists. It will be overwritten. So if you have a previous file, it will be deleted, a new file will be created, and whatever you write in this program will be written onto that. So it's your responsibility if you want to create multiple output files, for example, for different executions of your program, remember to give different names. And there is a neat facility in the C++. I have written this as a fixed string, but I could have a character string variable called file name and give an appropriate value through variety of means, including cin, and that file name will be used to open the file. So these are standard. Again, as I said, any output file that you want to create and write to should follow this standard procedure. F open and examine the pointer. The pointer is null, shout, 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 get out, otherwise proceed. So notice that I have opened an input file and I have opened an output file. I will now do the processing on these text files almost in the same fashion as I was doing it for stdin and stdout, except that for stdin and stdout, I could have used, for example, get string and put string function. But I have to do it with file now. So let us see how we do it. F get s. So instead of get s, I say f get s. Notice the parameters, line string, comma 79, comma fp in. So fp in, which is an input file pointer internally, appears as a parameter. This statement says read from fp in a line, but at most 79 characters, and put the result in line string. Why 79 characters? Because line string I have defined as 80 characters. I do not know what line would contain, but I am just, of course, if there are less number of characters in that line, only less number of characters will be read. Now, look at the next while loop. While not FEOF FP. FEOF is another function call, which returns the status of the file whose pointer is mentioned as a parameter. So FPOF FPIN means, at this juncture, has the file ended? Has the flag for end of file been set? If so, operating system will return true. If no, it will return false. So not of false will be true. So as long as the end of file is not set, keep repeating. This is the equivalent of the logic that we are seeing. While not end of file, keep doing this. Keep doing what? I have received a valid string, separate the four parts. So I will separate out. This is the logic. You can look at it in the videos. The logic is simple. I'll just extract all those up to comma, you know, and put them into separate strings. Then I am using extraction mechanism for relevant values as scanf. Notice we have just seen scanf. So for each string, sroll, sname, sbatch, smarks, I will extract using the format specifier into and sr, and sb, and sm, and sn, which itself is a string. This is just an example. I could have done it in n different ways. This is just to illustrate scan. Having done that now, I create an sprintf outstring. So I want to write an output line of text, but I want to create that line internally first. I don't want to write portions. I could do that by saying sprintf, and here I am writing sr, sn, sb, and sm, four values. Please note that these are all internal values. This is integer, this is a character string, this is integer, this is floating point. But using sprintf, all of these will be put as ASCII characters. Notice an important thing that has happened here. I am specifying the width. So this is 5 characters long, this is 30 characters long, this is 3 characters long, this is 5.2 means 5 characters long. Consequently, the output string that I am creating has now a fixed length. Earlier, the lines were of different length depending upon the length of the name. If some name was very large, that line would have been larger. But here, it does not matter. All lines are now fixed length characters. There is an advantage of having fixed length lines on the file, or fixed length record on the file, that we shall see in a moment. So is this clear how I am creating an output string like this? And this, to actually put it on the output file, I use fputs. Please note that the file fpout has been opened successfully. So every time I say fputs, an outstring is written. An outstring is written. An outstring is written. Notice that in the outstring, I am deliberately inserting a backslash n. So it will be actually a text file. If I use a text editor or anything, it will look like a normal text file. It will have a new line character, everything. Right? Of course, for the next iteration, I'll get the next line. I'll augment the counter by one. End of the while loop, I'll go back and keep doing this. When I finish this, I will put all the statistics output. But I should not forget to say F close FPIN and F close FP out. FPIN and FP out are closed properly. In short, the only difference in using external files for processing data as compared to STDN and STDOut is a simple extension of a similar conceptual mechanism, but the major difference. You define files by using file pointers. You use fopen initially at the beginning of the program to associate the file pointers with external files. You use fgets and fputs instead of gets and puts for handling character string. There are other functions which we shall see. You test for end of file flag for reading input data. And at the end, you actually explicitly close FP in and FP out. That is your responsibility. STD in and STD out are opened and closed by operating system. But any such text file that you handle, you will have to be explicitly closed just as you have to explicitly open. Is that clear? So file processing is basically a simple affair, but there is much more to file processing than just reading data sequentially and writing data sequentially, and that is what we shall like to look at. Observe that we were writing fixed length records of text there. Why is it necessary to write records as text? Why should I waste 5 spaces to write a floating point value with point something, or 10 spaces for it, when a floating point variable requires only 4 bytes? Okay. Why should I write an integer which could be 7 digit long in 7 ASCII characters when a 7-digit integer number can be stored internally in 4-byte int. Why can't I define a structure which has components, all these 4 components, and I write the entire structure in an internal format only on the external file? As long as I can read the entire structure in exactly the same fashion, it should not matter to me. I am not going to edit data on external files manually. My programs only are going to look at that data. That is possible if I define a structure. So here is a structure for student info, for example. It has integer role, character name 30, int batch, float marks. How many bytes such a structure would occupy? Quickly. 4 here, 30 here, 4 here, 4 here. Unfortunately, all compilers, when they allocate memory, they insist on allocating memory to different components starting at what is known as word boundary. That means the starting address of any component element has to start at a multiple of 4. The first one will start at multiple for 4, but the next one has 30 bytes. So at the end of 30 bytes, the next byte is not a multiple of 4 address. So 2 more bytes are actually used as a buffer byte. Consequently, the size of this entire thing will work out to 44 bytes and not 42 bytes. Now, how do you and I know what is the size? I mean, this is, we can understand and count, but if we just do a counting, and if I have a complex structure, who will do the counting? Please remember, a structure can have structure itself as an element. It could have array as an element, all kinds of. So there is a mechanism in C++ that when you define a structure variable, say student info s, you already know, if I define a student a variable s of the structure type, then the individual elements of s can be accessed by s.role, s.name, s.batch, and s.marks. Okay? The size in bytes of a structure can be found by using size of operator. So if you say size of struct student info, not of the variable, of the type, what is the size of that type? The structure is a type that you have defined. And this you can store in an integer variable, say rec size. If you print that rec size, it will turn out to be 44 bytes. It doesn't matter. You need to know exactly what is the size of that rec. Okay. So you have now created a structure for containing students' information in an internal format, where roll number is an int, the name is a string, the batch is an int, and marks is a float. No text, no nothing, in internal format. I would like to create a database file of students in which records after records contain such structures for one student, second student, third student, fourth student. And please note, a structure has a fixed length record. So I would be creating a file which will have fixed number of bytes in each record for each student. Having fixed record length has certain advantages because of the peculiar nature of disk files which are stored in either your CDs or memory sticks or on hard disks or wherever. And that facility is that you can access data in a binary file directly by going to any position. Just like in an array, you can go by an index I to ith position. On a disk, you can go to any position and access the data. So let's see how a direct access binary file operates in an operating system environment. Every file which is opened will have an associated file pointer. We already mentioned that, say FP. But operating system maintains an additional internal position indicator. This position indicator is internally positioned at some byte position. That is the position where any read-write will happen. Upon opening a file, the position is set at 0, which is beginning of the file. This is done by operating system. Please note that ordinarily this is not stored in a variable or something by operating system. It is maintained by operating system. But every time I do read or write, it happens at this position. So if for some reason the position is here, any read will happen so many bytes from here, or any write will happen bytes from here. And any time I do a read or write operation, this internal current internal position indicator will be advanced by the number of bytes read or written. All this is done by the operating system. So if I am at the beginning of the file and suppose I read 44 bytes from this point, means I issue a read command to read one structure variable. So it will read 44 bytes. The position will now be at 44th byte. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 43 would have been read 40. So automatically every read or write operation will keep advancing this. And that is how you can process the data sequentially if you so wish. But if you want, you can say, I want to go to the byte number 24,538. And from that byte position, I want to read 100 bytes. Such funny things are possible, such interesting things are possible, and such useful things are possible. Let's see how. If I want to be able to go to any place and read or write, I should have a capability of A, setting this current internal position to a desired point. I should also have a capability of knowing where the current position is. So knowing and setting are the two important things I should be able to do, for which C++ provides a facility. The first facility, to find out what is the current internal position. There is a function called ftel. Tel is a very appropriate verb. Tell me where you are. So ftel fp, if fp is a file pointer, operating system will look at its internal position and return that byte number. And that is what you store in, say, POS. Notice that by definition, by requirement of C++, POS cannot be a simple integer variable, it has to be a long variable. So you declare long pause. Anytime in your program you say pause equal to ftel fp, it will, operating system will tell you, look, I am exactly at this point. So if you open the file and say ftel, you will get 0, because that is where the point. But otherwise it will tell you exactly where it is. That is one part. But if you want to access a file at a specific position, you should be able to tell the operating system that I want the pointer to be set there. So I want to tell the operating system, I don't care where you are, or even if I know where you are, I want you to seek to this position. This is done by another function called fseek. The word seek comes from the old traditional disk architecture, where there is an arm and there are tracks on the disk, and that magnetic arm will actually move forward or backward to go to a desired track on the disk. And that operation used to be called a seek operation. That means that arm is seeking to go to a track. That is why the word seek has come, and the function name is fseek. Please note, fseek has three parameters: a file pointer fp, the position where I want to go directly, say p. Again, p, like your pause, has to be a long int variable. So you have declared in long p, and you set p equal to 1,25,438, or any arbitrary number. You will go to that particular byte position. But from where you count that byte position is very interesting, because if this is your file, for example, then you have some pointer at this point. Now, when you say go to this byte position, you are actually not giving an absolute position, you are giving a displacement. And this displacement can be counted from the beginning, can be counted from the current position, or can be counted from the end. I can say go to minus 20 position from end, or I can say go to 100th byte from beginning, or I can say go to 112 bytes from wherever you are currently. Consequently, when I specify a p, so please note, p is not an absolute byte number ordinary. P is a displacement. And that displacement can be relative to either beginning or the current position or at the end. And with reference to what you are giving that displacement is indicated by the third parameter, which is seek underscore set. Is the name of the parameter which indicates from the beginning. So if you say seek underscore set as the third parameter, then p is actually an absolute byte number. You go to that particular byte, right? There are other parameters possible, other values. For this parameter, seek set is seek cur, c-u-r-r, seek underscore cur for the current position, and seek underscore end for the end position. These are artificial names which are predefined names in C++. They actually translate into values 0, 1 and 2. 0 means from the beginning, 1 means from the current position, and 2 means from the end backward. Do you understand how significant this facility is of FC? I can actually go, it doesn't matter if there are millions of bytes or trillions of bytes, I can go to any position in that file directly. Directly going means the amount of time saved is enormous. Can you imagine what it would mean to go to that byte by reading one byte at a time and then going there? That is the difference. Sequential processing versus direct processing. Once you go to that position, you can read or write data at that position. Now, we come to the fixed length record advantage. We know the record size, number of bytes in the record, say it is S. If we know the relative position of the record, that this student is on 53rd position, or he is the 53rd student, first, second, third, fourth, 53rd student, then I can subtract 1 from that record number multiplied by S. That is the byte position in the file. So if I know the mapping between the roll number of a student and the position in the record, in the file, I can directly access that. This is a facility which is not possible in a text file at all. I have, let's say, 4 lakh students appearing for joint entrance examination. I have a file containing all 4 lakh students. And I want to find out some details about one student. I have no choice but to locate that student sequentially scanning the whole thing. But if I have a mechanism to map the roll number of that student into a record position, then I can directly access that. So I use FC to go to S star R minus 1 from the beginning, and I read the next S bytes for my record. These are some relevant C++ functions for reading and writing to direct access files. FRead and FWrite. Simple functions. FRead will read from the file FP as many records as you specify here by the third parameter of the size rec size. And it will read those records in a structure referenced by AND S. You have to pass actually AND S, you have to pass the reference. This S ordinarily would be one record variable in which you are holding one student's data. And that is why you will say 1. So one record can be read into a struct variable S. For writing one record, I do the exactly same thing, F write into this. This must be opened as an output file, of course, and I can write this the rec size. But this is a tremendously powerful statement. For example, instead of AND S, I could have an array of structures, 1000, and I could give the beginning pointer there, and here I could write instead of 1000. All bytes will be read in one shot. I can read chunks, 10 students' data at a time. I can do a variety of tricks that I wish to do. That is the power of the read and write. I can read any number. The total number of bytes read are simply the multiplication of the second and third parameter. So I can put any number of bytes and any number of records for that bytes. Okay, so that will be read or read. If the current pointer is somewhere and I want to reset it, there is a simple command called rewind. This comes from the old tapes, which are spools, which are rewound, you know. So rewind means go at the beginning. Of course, I can also do the same thing by saying fseek to 0, which is same as rewind. Having done that, here is a program which creates a binary file of the student's data from the input text file, which was produced as an output by our previous program. So look at how it does. I say fp input as fopen marksdata.txt, fp output fopen student db. This is an arbitrary name I have given, student db, no file extension, no nothing. But I open it as wb. W is for writing, b means binary. So I am now creating a binary file, it is not a text file. So there will be some special housekeeping information that the operating system may keep about that file, which is different from a text file. Okay. As usual, I check whether fp out is null. Otherwise, I will start processing like this. Notice, I read the input string. I create s.roll, s.batch, s.marks, and I string copy s.name. What I am doing? Elements of S, which is a structure variable, is being given appropriate values for one student. And then I use fwrite. Fwrite is the command which writes one record on FP output from an S, which is the reference variable. Please note, I am actually creating output records one at a time, because I am reading input lines one at a time. Whatever I read, I create output. Read, I create output. I can keep doing fwrite, and then I can keep doing fscanf to read the next line. Standard while iteration, while not feof of fp input. Okay. So that's it. The program will end by saying fclose fp input, fclose fp out. This is very similar to how we created an output text file. The difference is this time we have created a binary file. It has a fixed length record, and each record contains values in an internal format which we cannot decipher if we directly display the file contents on screen, because it is an int and float and whatever one. But it's okay, because we propose to read that data in exactly the same structure. We don't care. Now you will understand why 2's complement or floating point representation, etc., etc., has to be same across all different compilers. Otherwise, you could have problems. You have written a file on one machine and you are trying to read it on another machine, you could have a problem. In fact, there are some differences sometimes, and that is the reason why even the binary files many times contain data in either a string format or in a format called BSD, for example, which contains half byte digits, so decimal digits, some compression internally. Next, we discuss the program to handle this data. One, so there are three components. This is the last program on the videos that have been uploaded. This program illustrates two different things. One, given a roll number, how do I search sequentially? Second, it illustrates, given a record number, how a record is read directly. And third, it illustrates, given a roll number and some implicit mapping, how the record of that roll number is directly read, value change, and rewritten at the same place on the disk. This is something which is not possible with text files. So let's look at what this program does. It defines the struct and other things. Please note, it calculates the rake size, the size of struct, that is what is relevant. Please note that it is now opening the same student DB file which we created, but this time it is opening as RB plus. R is for reading ordinal. B is, it's a binary file, not a text file. Plus means I will not only read, but I may modify. So this is an update kind of file opening mode. Okay. First, the basic housekeeping. I open the file and I check whether the pointer is null for whatever reason. But the processing, sequential processing is like this. Rewind FP. I need not give this command, just to illustrate that rewind can be given at any time and your position at the beginning. Now I am searching for marks of roll number 10105. I do a sequential search, except that the file is a binary file. So I calculate what the current pos is, just for my information, and I want to find marks for roll number 10105. So I will put up an iteration, which will, I am using a do while loop. Okay, so do what? The while comes here, while not end of a file of FP, this is the do loop, and inside that I am reading one record from the file, and if s dot roll of that record is R, I have found the student. So it's just a sequential. What is important to note is the file stored the data in an internal format, and it read correctly that internal format. I just have to access the element called s dot roll, and if I find it, I will print s dot marks. I got it. I can also find out which is the record number, because I am also finding out the pos at a current time, and which I can convert into a record number using the records. Next is a slightly more involved thing. We want to demonstrate direct access to records. So find and print the sixth record in database file. First, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth record. Where is the sixth record found? The 0th byte, first record. One rec size later, second record. So number of records, that is record position minus one, multiplied by the rec size is the starting point. I calculate rec number as 6, I assign 6 as rec number because I want to read the 6th record. I calculate the position, pos, which I have defined as long. So pos is rec num minus 1 into rec size. And then I do what? F seek. So I F seek to that position, set the file position. And the moment I F seek, the file pointer internally has gone there, I simply F read one record. This will be the 6th record. Notice how easy it is. If I know the record position, 1,25,434th record, minus 1 into rec size, I seek to that position, read one record. Then I can print that record starting at this byte position itself. So this is the direct access. This is the peculiarity of the binary file, which is, I repeat, not available with text files. Now, I go one step forward. There is a student called Neelmani Raut. His roll number is 10108. I want to update Neelmani Raut's mark. Let's say he had 91.5. Now his paper has been re-examined. He should get, let's say, 93.5. So what I want to do, I want to read Neelmani Raut's record. I want to change the marks inside. And I want to rewrite it exactly at the same position at which the original record was. But here, now I am making some assumption. I am saying, how do I conclude it is 8th record? I am saying that because his roll number is 108. This time, I am presuming a mapping between roll number and record position. Let me show you how I am presume that map. R is 10108. So basically, I have to read the record of roll number 10108. Notice what I am doing. I am calculating rec num as R minus 10100. What is the assumption here? All the students that I have, they are sequentially given roll numbers starting with 10101, 10102, 10103 till eternity. What if roll numbers were given like that, but some 4 students left in between? Well, for a simple mapping like this, it is worthwhile to create space for those 4 jokers also and keep nothing inside those records. But if I do that, I will have sequentially records 10101, 10102, 10103. If I have 10,000 students, I have 10,000 records like that. You get the advantage now? Once I have all the records, doesn't matter if some students are missing, I can map the roll number into a record position through a simple mathematical arithmetic expression. POS is rec num minus 1 into rec size. I do the F seek and I do an F read. I know I got Neelmani Raut's marks. The science of doing this mapping is extensively studied in other areas such as databases and so on. You will notice that you have studied binary trees. There are search trees for desk called B trees. There are index files, index them. So you spend a lot of reads in order to find out the position of a record and then go to that record diary. Because reading from disk is very costly. Conventional disk is at least 1,000 times slower than main memory. That is why in main memory you have an array, you can handle 4 byte elements. It takes the same time wherever. But on a disk, since it is 1,000 times costly to go to a particular position, you don't generally read 4 bytes, you read many bytes. You read one full record, etc. Most important thing is mapping between the record position and the desired key attribute such as roll number. Here is one example. There could be many other examples of such mapping. So given this, I can read this record. I have read it now. What I wish to do? I want to update Neelmani Raut's marks. S dot marks is equal to 93.5. will simply update inside the memory the component called marks. S is the structure in which Neelmani Raut's record has been read. I have updated. But I want to rewrite it. Can I just say F write? What would happen if I did F write now? Please note that the previous F read, it read Neelmani Raut's record, but it has advanced the internal pointer further. If I do any write, it will write the next fellow actually. In fact, if I blindly do an F-write, it will write Neelmani Raut's new record, obliterating somebody else's record, And Nilmani Raut will have now two records the file. That is not correct. What I must do now? I must bring back that current position to where the Nilmani Raut's record began. And that is why, since the previous raid has advanced the internal position, I do an F-seek again. I already know the POS. I had calculated it. I used F-seek there. So I can do F-seek any number of times. When I do this F-seek, the internal file pointer is brought back to the beginning of Nilmani Raut's record. And now when I do an F-write, it will update the write record. There are a few more lines of code written just to confirm that you actually updated Nilmani Raut's record only. So you, what you do, you for verify, you read it again from the disk. But again you have to do an F-seek because even the write operation has advanced it further. So you do an F-seek and you do an F-read. There is, in the video, there is an execution screenshot given for the code blocks where you can see what happens. So is this clear how you can handle things? The crux of this is your ability to do a mapping, which is not as easy as it sounds, but it is possible. For example, suppose I was storing information about mobile numbers. Let's say I have a shop and I issue mobile numbers to people and I have been given a bunch of mobile numbers to give. Let's say they all start from 98200 and then 10000. So I can give, I can sell 20,000 numbers or 50,000 numbers like that. Now it should be possible for me to do a simple mapping. I will create records as 98200100010001100002. And I can create such 10,000 records. So for each customer, I have a record. What could that record contain? The name of the customer, the address of the customer, the proof that he gave a scanned copy, a PDF file pointer, or some file name, or something like that. And the current value of money for using to make phone calls. 200 rupees, 1000 rupees, 500 rupees. Given a telephone number, suppose somebody comes to my shop and says, I want to recharge my account by 300 rupees. So I say, what is your mobile number? I have a C++ program running here. I enter that mobile number. I do this mapping. I directly access that fellow's record. And I say, how much value? 200 rupees. I read that record, type 200. I do exactly the same process, add 200 to his balance and update that record. This is a simplistic mechanism. Please note that for actual operations, this entire file is required to be connected to the service provider's infrastructure. Because after all, that service provider must know that 200 rupees have been added. And that information must go back to your mobile through the service provider when you ask for a balance. So all that happens in a distributed fashion, multiple programs running elsewhere. F close is absolutely mandatory. You must close the file that you open. So this is the practice problem. Assume that a binary file mobile.bin contains mobile information like mobile number or mobile recharge balance, etc. It has multiple other information. Please note this down because the problem itself is defined into two or three different slides. This is very simple. You just need to write down the name of the file called mobile.bin. And it contains information like mobile number and mobile recharge amount, or you may call it mobile balance. Okay. Now first, you want to write a main program which will open a binary file for reading and writing. The main program will call two functions. These two functions, please write down their names. Mobile number exists function. And the second function is update recharge amount function. Mobile number exists function. As the name suggests, it would return a boolean, right? Mobile number exists. Yes or no? I mean, somebody says, this is my mobile number, charge 200 rupees. Either that fellow may tell me a wrong number or I might make a mistake in entering. The mobile number may not exist in my database. Please note that if I have done simplistic mapping, then all mobile numbers will exist in the file, but whether an actual mobile number is active or not can be indicated by a field inside them. For example, I can say not active. So that means that mobile number does not exist. Or the record itself may not exist. Either way, you can take a call. But these are the two functions that you have to run. Now, what do you do in these two functions? The function update recharged amount should be called only if the function mobile number exists returns true. So declare these two functions with the required return value and the parameters that need to be passed. Please note you are dealing with files. Okay. And both these functions may be required to access the file. The first function to determine whether the number is there or not, meaning that number is active or not. Now, this is something that you should note down. Write the first function mobile number exists to check whether the mobile entered by the user exists in the binary file. Exists as an active record or exists at all, depending upon how you have decided the mapping. If it exists, the function should return true to the main program from where it is called. Your main program actually does two things. A customer comes to me, tells me here 200 rupees is my mobile number. So my main program will collect an input as mobile number. Then the main program will call this function that you are writing. Okay, mobile number exists. It will return true or false. If it returns true, then I will go to the next function, update recharge. And the next function does what? To update the binary file with the new recharge value. So obviously the main program should collect the input as 200 rupees, 500 rupees, 1000 rupees, whatever is the recharge amount. And the second function should do what that program did to update Nilmani Raut's marks. Okay, it should read that record, it should update the balance, and it should rewrite it at that case. So the actual function writing is very simple because it is very similar to the sample program illustration program that has been given, except that you are now required to write it as two functions, both callable from the main program. So issues like where would you open the file? Obviously, it does not make sense to open the file inside each function. Best is to open the file outside. But then you may have to pass the file pointer for the actual activities to happen. There is a position. Okay. When the first function, okay, finds out whether the number exists or not, while doing so, it would have located the position. Would you like your update function to redo that work again? Or would you like to have some mechanism to get the position that has been computed by that? Okay. A better specification could have been that this is not a binary function, but it is actually a long function, the first function, which returns the starting point, or it returns minus one if it does not, for example. So I could do, see, these are the design decisions that you will take. Why I am telling you these elaborate mechanisms is that there is no unique way of solving a general data processing problem. And when you design your projects, during the project design, these are the design decisions that you will have to take collectively. What parameters should be used where? How should the function be written? What should be the interpretation of values inside the records, etc. All right. Well, with that, we come to the end of this lecture. Thank you.